Bernie won Nevada. Is the world ending? I'll tell you in a second. Israel, Gaza, rockets falling on a playground. We'll talk about it. Finally, the 75th anniversary of the flag raising on Mount Suribachi in Iwo Jima. Something about that you may not know. All that's coming up right now on I'm Right. Bernie Sanders won Nevada, and Bernie Sanders is looking good in the polls, and the Democrats are panicking, and is the world coming to an end? Well, let's talk about that for a moment. One, yes, as of right now, Bernie Sanders is looking real strong in the Democratic primary, but if there's one thing I've learned, especially after having been married for this long, things can change on a dime. And what I mean by that is, look, we've got three states done. Yes, it's the first three states. No, they're not the biggest states in the world. They're not nothing, but it's three states done. And I may have to go back to community college to check, but I believe we have 50 states in the United States of America. What I'm saying is we still have South Carolina coming. We still have Super Tuesday coming. We have candidates who will and are running out of money. They're going to drop. Their supporters are going to go elsewhere. Everything we have right now indicates the Democrat Party as a whole, and every cable news pundit is horrified about the fact that it might be Bernie Sanders. So you have to assume so many of those voters are going to go to someone else, maybe like Bloomberg, maybe like Buttigieg. Well, not Elizabeth Warren, but you get the idea. Don't panic just yet. But let's assume for a moment that it does turn out to be Bernie Sanders. There are a couple different ways you can feel about that. One, should it scare you? A little. It shouldn't terrify you. It's not the time to hide underneath your bed, you know, and stash all your money in a mayonnaise jar in the backyard. But look, the fact that it would be Bernie Sanders if he was the nominee, a little scary. The guy does have an excitement behind him. On top of that, I mean, I don't think Donald Trump's going really has a decent chance of being bounced from office, but it could happen. An actual real scandal could happen, even though the public probably has no time for that now after all the fake scandals for the last 3 years. An economic recession could happen. So don't make this mistake on the right of thinking, well, we want it to be Bernie because Trump will crush him. Things happen, ladies and gentlemen. Things happen. Don't be too hasty about wanting the full-blown communist to get the Democrat nomination. Remember, we are, above all, patriots. We do want what's best for the United States of America, meaning let's say the worst thing happened in 2020 and Donald Trump was bounced from office and lost his reelection campaign. We don't want a communist taking over as president of the United States. On top of the damage he would do, think about how embarrassing that is for us on the world stage. Do you really want that old fool sitting in the White House? No, you do not. But a couple things. Maybe this is exactly what we need as a nation. Maybe we need Bernie Sanders to get the nomination. Why? Because look, we even have leftist pundits out there right now complaining about socialism. Maybe we have a whole bunch of people, probably 40% or so in this country, that support socialism. And the only way you can support socialism is you've never been taught about the horrors of socialism. And Bernie's nomination might just prompt some actual news coverage of how horrific socialism actually is. Maybe we would finally get an examination of how awful all collectivism is. Now, I realize the kids can't get that in government schools these days, but maybe for once when you turned on the news, you'd find out that capitalism isn't that bad, right? Maybe that would be a benefit of it. But make no mistake about it, Bernie Sanders is going to spend every minute from now until Election Day in 2020, assuming he's the nominee, one, giving away things. Everything is a giveaway. Well, they gave him this, they gave him that. Remember something, whether it be from Bernie Sanders or any other Democrat or any Republican, the government gives nothing away that they didn't first take from somebody else. Remember that. Also, Bernie's going to do this thing where he's going to try to walk back or put a nice shine on all his horrific comments from the past. And let's be honest, there are lots of them. Bernie Sanders honeymooned in communist Soviet Union. Bernie Sanders has had some really loving things to say about people like Castro.
He educated their kids, gave them health care, totally transformed the society.
We're very opposed to the authoritarian nature of Cuba. But, you know, it's unfair to simply say everything is bad. You know, when Fidel Castro came into office, you know what he did? He had a massive literacy program. Is that a bad thing? Even though Fidel Castro did it?
That's what you're going to hear a lot of, people. Fidel Castro lined people up and shot them in the face. Fidel Castro jailed everybody who opposed him politically. That's if they didn't disappear somewhere. Fidel Castro is a monster. That he put in some kind of literacy program for everybody he didn't murder is not necessarily a big benefit, and that's no reason to praise somebody awful like Fidel Castro. And I want you to understand something I've told you before, something I'm going to tell you again. All these people, whether it be Castro, Lenin, Pol Pot, Mao, whoever it may be, pick your radical nutjob commie who came to power, not a single one of them came to power promising, I'm going to murder everybody who opposes me. Now, I'm not saying that's what Bernie's going to do, but every single one of those guys I just named, every one of them came to power promising these exact same things. Well, I'm not going to hurt anybody. Well, I'm going to give you this. I'm going to give you that. Well, yeah, we're going to stick it to them, but those are just the rich guys. Don't worry about that. I'm going to give you lots of stuff. They all carry the same message. The problem for Bernie is, and this is the problem for every single socialist, and frankly, most of the Democrats running for public office right now, is when you actually ask them little things like, how are you going to pay for it? These are the kind of answers you get.
How much will that cost?
Obviously, those are expensive propositions, but we have done our best on issue after issue in paying for them.
Do you know how much, though? I mean, do you have a price tag for all this?
We do. I mean, you know, the price tag is, it will be substantially less than letting the current system go. I think it's about $30 trillion.
That's just for Medicare for all?
Just Medicare for all, yes.
Do you have a price tag for all of these things?
No, I don't. You mentioned making public colleges and universities tuition-free and canceling all student debt. That's correct. That's what I want to do. We pay for that through a modest tax on Wall Street speculation.
But you say you don't know what the total price is, but you know how it's going to be paid for. How do you know it's going to be paid for if you don't know how much the price is?
Well, I can't rattle off to you every nickel and every dime, but we have accounted for it. You talked about Medicare for All. We have options out there that will pay.
Oh, my gosh. That person has a good chance of being the Democrat nominee for president. So back to what I said in the beginning, yeah, you should be a little nervous. That person can never have any significant power in the United States of America. Let us let him rise to the highest he'll ever rise, and that being a senator for 9,000 years who never gets a bill passed, and that's pretty much where that guy should stop. And let's be honest about Bernie. I mean, I'm about to play you a clip of Chris Matthews freaking out. Bernie, it's like the Nazis taking over all this. Bernie's plans are not that different from all the other Democrats' plans. You've got guys like Pete Buttigieg saying, I believe it was yesterday, out there on the campaign trail, hey, we want the same things. We just want to go about it a different way. They're all proposing stuff like this. It is horrific. And it's what keeps me from ever being able to vote against the Republican Party. Let's be honest, the Republican Party, lots of the time, most of the time, maybe all the time, sucks. But it's way, way, way better than, well, I don't know, we can't put a price tag. Oh, it's a moderate tax on Wall Street speculation. That's not $30 trillion, you moron. Chris Matthews has joined the ranks of every other liberal pundit in realizing Bernie Sanders likely means a complete wipeout of the Democratic Party in 2020. Here he is making a comparison of Bernie with the only historical piece that apparently any liberal knows in the country.
Bernie, on the other hand, did his job. He got more than a majority of that 67%. That is the name of the game. It is pretty much over unless that changes. I was reading last night, Brian, I know you're a history guy too. I'm reading last night about the fall of France in the summer of 1940. And the general, Renault, calls up Churchill and says, it's over. And Churchill said, how can it be? You got the greatest army in Europe. How can it be over? He said, it's over. So I had that suppressed feeling. I can't be as wild as Carville, but he is damn smart. And I think he's damn right on this one.
For one, can we dial that? Can somebody please by a history book for one of these cable news pundits, everything is not the Nazis. Everything is not Hitler. It is so weird how they have to tie everything back to that. I don't know if people are aware, but there's like thousands of years of human history recorded that, I mean, there's other stuff that happened. Setting that aside, it is kind of fun to watch all these guys who've pushed for lower levels of socialism all these years finally get the socialist they really kind of asked for and now turn around and cry about it. Ladies and gentlemen, if you're in the liberal news media, he's exactly what you've wanted. Enjoy yourself. All that may have made you uncomfortable, but I'm right. Coming up next, we have our very own Buck Sexton. Hang on. Joining me now, pretty much my favorite person in the world, Buck Sexton. He needs no introduction on this channel because, let's be honest, he's a star on this channel, The Buck Sexton Show. Buck, Bernie doesn't have a problem with Castro. I mean, obviously he doesn't love the authoritarian stuff, but they taught everyone how to read.
Well, you know, you don't usually hear people say things like, okay, you know, Hitler did some bad stuff, but the Nazi war on cancer was really something to marvel at. I mean, usually we can trust that people don't do this, you know? I mean, I'm sure there were some efficiencies of the Pol Pot regime that one could point to, but usually the whole extermination of people not politically aligned with the regime is what gets the focus. Look, Bernie Sanders is an unrepentant friend to communists. If this were still in the Cold War era, he would be called a fellow traveler. And, you know, his problem with these systems is not that they're inherently flawed, Jesse. It's that he just thinks that the systems, this is, of course, the great excuse of socialists and communists all through history, is that the system just wasn't really done the way it should have been done. But overall, it was a good idea. This is why we have a big problem with Bernie Sanders.
Buck, I'm going to ask you a big, broad psychological question here because I genuinely want to know. Bernie Sanders, I have to assume, is not a dunce. I mean, I don't assume his IQ is 60. I don't. There's no indication of that. The guy's been alive for about 10,000 years. So he knows everything you and I know. He's read the same history books. I mean, he's seen it all. What actually goes through that guy's mind when he wants to put socialism in the United States of America? I genuinely want to know. Is that just it, what you just said? He should just be the one to figure out how to do it? How can anybody sign on to an ideology that has failed ugly every single time it's been tried?
Well, he's really a redistribution fundamentalist. And when you think about it that way, I feel like everything becomes a lot more clear. He's somebody who has spent decades being able to essentially say the same nonsensical things, but that make people feel good to hear. It makes him feel good to say. It keeps him employed. He's effectively a community organizer of sorts for the last 60 or 70 years or whatever. Last 60 years, I'd say. He's not that old. But, you know, the reality of Bernie Sanders is that, you know, he has a fever and the only prescription is more socialism. And that's just been the way that he's always approached politics and his role in public life. So why would he change now? He's gotten this far. And, you know, being a socialist means you get to act like you're a good person. Other socialists feel like you're a good person. You don't have to engage in any really serious debate because, at least until now, nobody was going to take any of his policies seriously. And so it's gotten him this far. He's been able to do this without having to actually really look into, like, the price tag, for example, which they're saying is probably $90 trillion. That's a lot of money.
That's a lot of money. All right, so is he inevitable, Buck? I mean, I know you and I have had this talk on your radio show before. I find it hard to believe he's inevitable when we're done with three states. Why is it inevitable for Bernie?
I feel like we've also had this talk on the now syndicated Jesse Kelly show, just to throw that out there. But indeed, I think that he's inevitable based on the process the Democrats have now. But I also think that the process itself can't be considered an inevitability, given the willingness to, let's just be honest, let Bloomberg in despite the donor threshold question to the debates. There's a panic in the Democratic establishment. And last time they had the superdelegates to call upon to kind of keep Bernie at bay. This time around, who knows? And remember, these are people who are still willing to believe that Russia, with a couple of internet trolls, can change a U.S. national election. So they'll believe anything and they'll convince themselves of anything. And that means that if they have to take extreme measures to prevent Bernie Sanders from being the candidate, they'll do it. And they'll think that they're doing the right thing, too.
Speaking of extreme measures, I have never seen the leftist hacks in our media become this committed to going against one of their own, meaning they are all destroying Bernie Sanders. Now, conventional thinking says, okay, let's assume he gets the nomination, they all fall back in line and just ignore it. But how do you walk back some of these comments, Buck? We have Chris Matthews comparing Bernie's takeover to Nazi Germany, because of course, that's the only historical reference any of them understand. How do you walk back some of these things?
Yeah, I don't think you do. I think they just pretend they never said it, and they ignore it when people put back in their faces what they said a mere few months ago. I mean, never-Trumpers have really perfected this, right? I mean, never-Trumpers are now, many of them, saying they'd support Bernie Sanders over Trump, when at the beginning of this whole thing, when they were the true conservatives, Jesse, as you'll recall, like, well, I mean, I wouldn't support a socialist over Trump. I'm not that crazy. Well, now when you ask them about this, they're like, oh, no, socialism better than Trump. Sure. Whatever they have to say to keep the grift going. Same thing with Democrats in the media. Doesn't matter. You can play for them. It's the ultimate gaslighting to play what they've actually said in the past and say, do you still believe this? They'll just look at you and be like, I don't even know what you're talking about. It works for them. It'll work for Chris Matthews.
Let's take the most likely scenario at this point in time, and that's that Bernie's the nominee, Trump blows him out. That's obviously the likely scenario and the one we all hope for, but that's likely. But still, Bernie's going to get 40%, Buck, 41% of the vote easily. How did we get to a place, setting aside Bernie, how do we get to a place in the United States of America where, I mean, we fought against the commies forever, and now 40% of the country's okay with this? This stuff only rises in countries that suck because the people want to throw off their leadership. It doesn't happen in a wealthy country. How did it happen in ours?
Well, I think it's going to be closer than that, Jesse, because you have to remember that Democrats will vote for a Democrat even if he's really a socialist, as long as he's not Trump. And so baked into the cake, I think you have an election that's going to be determined by a few hundred thousand votes again. Now, how that plays out in the Electoral College, I think Trump does have a shot, for example, New Hampshire. I think he's going to win everything that he won against Hillary and then add a few states to it. But in the aggregate vote totals, I mean, it's not going to be a blowout like we saw with Mondale or even Dukakis, I think. So here's what I would say about how we got to this point. People tend to want the state to save them when things are really bad, but we're actually on the other end of the pendulum right now, where people want the state to do more because things are so good, and they forget what it's like when the government is grinding them down into dust. You know, they forget the DMV reality of government approaches to helping us in our existence, because right now unemployment is so low, people are prosperous, we're not fighting any big crazy wars. That's when you have people that say, yeah, maybe we could do more government fixing everything. And I think, unfortunately, we've forgotten the lessons of the past. So I think that in either really bad circumstances, by the way, the big rise of socialism came from the Great Depression in the West. I mean, people said capitalism has failed. Now it's capitalism has succeeded so well that people are thinking maybe we could do a little less capitalism and even it out with some socialism. They don't understand that socialism is incremental. It always tends toward authoritarianism, and it destroys wealth, and that's what it will do again. Boom.
Buck Sexton of the Buck Sexton Show. We're just going to let you leave that cherry on top right there. Appreciate you, my man.
You too, sir.
All right. I have more because I'm me. Hang on. Well, more explosions, more violence over there in Gaza. It is ugly. Apparently, the people who live in Israel have to wake up to this kind of crap every single day. And look, I am not one of these people who believes that Israel has never done anything wrong. I think that's absurd. But they are our ally. And I hate it that anybody in this world has to wake up with the possibility of rockets falling on their kids' playgrounds every single day. I think it's absolutely horrific what Hamas has done to that region. I think it's horrific that it has been allowed to go on as long as it has. I think Israel should be commended by how generous and how nice they have been, considering they hold the complete military capability of wiping Palestine completely off the map. And more than anything else, I think it sucks that we have American politicians who are terrorist sympathizers. And I don't know a nicer way to put that. I'm not trying to be extreme. But think about what we've seen, especially over the past couple years. Think about the comments we've seen from people like Rashida Tlaib. Think about Ilhan Omar being caught on camera laughing when asked about Al-Qaeda. What am I supposed to make of that, ladies and gentlemen? And what am I supposed to make of this huge shift on the left, the socialist left, about their hatred of all things Israel? Look, you can agree or disagree about how involved we should be in Israel's affairs, but we can all agree they're an ally, right? In no way can that really be debated. And then we have the fact that they're surrounded by enemies of ours, although, gratefully, under President Trump, we appear to be making more friends over there than enemies. And that we have people like Bernie Sanders out there. He's giving statements like this. The Israeli people have the right to live in peace and security. So do the Palestinian people. I remain concerned about the platform AIPAC provides for leaders who express bigotry and oppose basic Palestinian rights. For that reason, I will not attend their conference. And for those of you who don't understand what AIPAC is, it's obviously a pro-Israel PAC. I've actually been to one of their conferences before. It's not political. It is flooded with Republicans. It's flooded with Democrats. It's just simply a pro-Israel PAC, and it's certainly not an anti-Palestinian PAC. It's an anti-shooting rockets into our playgrounds PAC. I would think that would be something that every single American could get behind, only apparently that only applies to the freedom-loving Americans, which, of course, Bernie is not. AIPAC released a statement in response saying, Senator Sanders has never attended our conference, and that is evident from his outrageous comment. In fact, many of his own Senate and House Democratic colleagues and leaders speak from our platform to over 18,000 Americans from widely diverse backgrounds. Democrats, Republicans, Jews, Christians, African Americans, Hispanics, Americans, progressives, veterans, students, members of the LGBTQ plus community who participate in the conference to proclaim their support for the U.S.-Israel relationship. Again, I will circle back to what I said in the very beginning. I understand when people out there want to talk about the United States, our assistance to Israel. I get that. I personally like it because Israel hates all the people we hate. I think it works out fine, but that's a perfectly legitimate conversation to have. Where you cross from that conversation into illegitimacy is when you say, sure, it's some rockets in a playground, but I mean, Israel sucks too. That's awful. And what's really terrible is that the left, the American left, has been able to get away with this for years. They encourage it. Do people understand what actually goes on inside Palestine? You understand that their children, there are plenty of videos about this online, pictures of it online. Their children, I don't mean 20 years old, I don't mean 15 years old. I'm talking 5 and 6 years old. Their children are taught to fight and kill Israelis, are taught to dress up like terrorists and go in and blow people up, that daily they're trying to cross the border and stab and kill people. More than anything else, maybe we ought to just all bow our heads every now and then and say a prayer for the people who have to live like that every single day in Israel, because they are a country who just wants to have peace with people around them, and everybody around them wants to kill them, and I think that freaking sucks. All right. We're going to talk about Joe Biden in South Carolina and what you can expect coming up. Hang on. People, I have a heavy heart today. I don't normally get too, you know, melancholy on the show, but I feel like Joe Biden's run is almost over. And do you have any idea how much I'm going to miss laughing at Joe Biden? Just, can we reflect back on it? You know what? At some point in time, I'm going to go ahead and put together a big compilation video of all the highlights of just this campaign from Joe Biden, whether it be touching a man a little bit too hard on the chest who said he wasn't supporting, turning around and yelling at a reporter. Remember, I think it was Ed O'Keefe when he turned around and went, why? bleeding from the eyes. He screwed up what state he's in 9,000 times, including a new one on a video I'm going to show you in just a minute or so. The guy is just terrible at this. He called somebody fat, a voter, and everybody heard it, and then the campaign denied it. He got caught up. He loved the Trump impeachment thing about the Ukraine, and then it came out. Well, Ukraine, you can't say the Ukraine, or these people who went to college get all upset. And then it turned out his son was involved in the worst Ukraine corruption around. I'm going to miss Joe Biden, people. I am going to miss him. But don't worry, South Carolina is his firewall, except sometimes it's not.
South Carolina, though, is your firewall.
You said it, my firewall. I've never
said it. The campaign has said it's your firewall.
No, it's not firewall. I said I'm going to do well there.
And I think I have a real firewall in South Carolina.
I've never
said it. The campaign has said it's your firewall.
No, it's not firewall. I said I'm going to do well there.
I'm going to miss it. The guy's just not good at this. And so I'm just going to make this a brief segment. I'm not going to blow your doors off with it because there's not much else to say about Joe until we get to South Carolina. And look, I don't think he's going to win South Carolina, people. Everyone's saying he's going to win it. The poll numbers look good. He's going to win it. Tell me how many people have seen how Joe Biden has performed in the previous three states, and they're running out there to pull the lever for Biden. Look, voters, they're motivated by different things. All voters are. And each candidate is going to have a certain percentage of their supporters who will lay down and die for them no matter what. That's just inevitable. But voters love a winner. Voters love to be able to say at the end, oh, he was my guy. I told you so. Didn't I tell you, Marty? I told you. Voters love that. Voters have a very, very, very difficult time walking in a booth and voting for somebody they're sure is going to lose. Joe Biden has been slaughtered in the first three states. Joe Biden, who got into this race and was a 20 or 30 point front runner, and now he's getting slaughtered. I'm telling you right now, write it down, Joe Biden is not going to win South Carolina. And mark my words, if he does win South Carolina, I'll forget I made this prediction and have no accountability for it whatsoever. Joe Biden, keep in mind, he needs South Carolina. His whole world is South Carolina. South Carolina is his firewall. South Carolina is the best. Everything is South Carolina. And even then, he calls it North Carolina.
Just a sense of certainty, just a sense of decency. And, you know, North Carolina has the highest eviction rate, of any state, of any place in the country, more than triple the national average. Now, by the way...
It's too good. The one state he needs. His entire campaign is hinging on it. And I know a lot of you may not have traveled to the Carolinas. I've done a bit of traveling in my time. They don't like North Carolina and South Carolina. CNN, they covered Joe Biden's Nevada caucuses, which didn't go very well either.
So it's just fascinating to watch these caucuses occur. I'm here at 6202, the precinct in Sparks, Nevada. And, you know, what happened was here at this precinct, you need 16 people for your candidate to be viable. And Biden had one person show up in person to caucus. And with the early vote all structured together, Warren had 15 people. And the one Biden woman, she walked over and she sat down and she caucused for Senator Warren, making her viable.
He had one show up and she defected to Elizabeth Warren. Gosh, if I had anybody ever leave my campaign for Elizabeth Warren, I would retire from politics forever and move to Siberia. Okay. You're going to want to see our little Iwo Jima section on this show. Just trust me. Hang on. Joining me now, John Thomas, a Republican strategist and host of the Thomas Guide podcast. John, I'm going to ask you to do the impossible. We have South Carolina coming up. Paint me a path to victory for Joe Biden. What is, not just in South Carolina, to win the nomination. What is his path?
Well, it's getting slimmer by the minute. I mean, the runway to change the outcome is getting shorter and shorter. So here's what I would do if I were advising Joe Biden. Buckle up and hold on and pray for luck. The problem is, if you look at the trend lines, Jesse, it just isn't it's not favoring Biden at this point. Biden's so-called firewall was South Carolina, right? And he's built up since day one expectations to be so high for this one state that if he doesn't win this state, even if there were an electoral path for him to recover, the expectations game will likely sink him. If Joe Biden doesn't come in a dominant first place in South Carolina, if anybody, whether it's Sanders or any other candidate in this race, beats him in South Carolina, Biden will be lucky if he can make it to Super Tuesday.
Do you think he even tries? I mean, look at it. I shouldn't put myself in someone else's shoes, but I mean, if I'm Joe Biden and I don't come in a dominant first place, like you said, in South Carolina, man, I take my pension and I ride off into the sunset because it is over.
Well, you have some common sense about you. Look, the egos of these politicians knows no bounds. The only reason politicians ever drop out of a race for president is simply because they can't make payroll anymore. So it's going to come down to whether or not Joe Biden thinks that he can pay to keep the lights on. If he has enough powder in the kitty, I think he goes to Super Tuesday, Jesse, because in a lot of states, like in California, there have been early voting going on now for several weeks, and Biden might just roll the dice. But in reality, if he doesn't have a good showing in South Carolina, even if he remains through Super Tuesday, his bid for the presidency is over.
Now that Joe Biden, let's just agree that was the long shot of long shots. Now that he's gone, what's a path to the nomination for anyone else besides Bernie? I mean, in my mind, these candidates have to start dropping out, which I do think will boost the candidates who aren't Bernie, because I think that's the only reason you're choosing anyone else except for Bernie at this point in time. But like you just pointed out, egos are big. As long as the lights are still on, what motivation do they have? Am I crazy?
Right. No, you're right. And it's a classic, you know, prisoner's dilemma. It's what we saw also in 2016. You know, these same arguments were being bantied around, Jesse, that if everybody would just consolidate around Ted Cruz or somebody, that Donald Trump could be beaten. Perhaps theoretically that would be right, but politicians are all self-interested here. They're only going to fold up shop if they absolutely can't pay to keep the lights on. So here's what I anticipate happening. I think Bloomberg wants this to become a perceived fight between Bernie and Bloomberg. But at this point, all projections seem to be that Bernie will have a delegate advantage going into the convention. There's almost no other way to slice it. And even if Joe Biden does come in first place in South Carolina, you could make the argument, Jesse, that that still does Bernie Sanders a favor, because that will further fragment that perceived center-left lane, allowing Bernie to continue to rack up delegates going in. I think the only thing we have yet to see is, what does Bloomberg do with his money? Does he end up going negative on Bernie? Because to date, Jesse, I know you see like a web ad here or there attacking Bernie Sanders, but Bloomberg could literally spend $100 million in negative advertising in 1 week against Bernie Sanders, but he hasn't yet. And the question is, will he ever?
That's a big irony of Michael Bloomberg. I think people do not realize how much money he's sunk into the Democrat Party as a whole, making sure they're elected across the country. He really is the ultimate company man. And I think he's at least signaled he intends to back whoever the nominee is. Now, I don't want to nerd out too much. When you brought up the delegates, you said Bernie being in the lead with the delegates at the convention. I think most people watching this are going to say, okay, then he won. Is that not the case?
No. What we're likely to see, usually the Democratic nominee does not actually get the requisite number of delegates to clinch the nomination. What happens is they have so many delegates locked up that it is all but a foregone conclusion that if it went to a broker convention, that the leader with delegates would likely get the nomination. Not necessarily in this case, particularly because the likely leader in delegates, being Bernie Sanders, is so hated by the Democratic establishment that at a brokered convention, you could see a floor fight where people galvanize around anybody but Bernie. Here's the problem, Jesse. I think the Democrats are damned if they do, they're damned if they don't. If you end up stealing this nomination. Let's hypothetically say Bernie's, well, he probably is going to be short. He's going to be the delegate leader, but he's going to be short of the magic number to clinch this this nomination. If the Democrats steal this nomination from Bernie Sanders, I think the party will split at the seams, perhaps alienating a class of voters, namely young Democrats, turning them against the Democratic Party, perhaps for the next decade. So this may be bigger to the Democratic Party than just one election cycle. They may have no choice but to give it to Bernie Sanders.
Now, I'm sorry, I find this stuff to be endlessly fascinating. Yeah. You mentioned a floor fight. I'm assuming that does not mean they're going to set up a big boxing ring and duke this thing out. What does a floor fight mean?
Well, it feels a little bit like these early caucuses where essentially you pledge there's votes, multiple rounds of voting, where candidates, all the delegates that are going to the convention can line up with their candidate of choice. So you can end up seeing a bunch of horse trading, or even Donald Trump in 2016. I know it feels like it was a long time ago, but he was worried about a floor fight and a potential broker convention. That's when he hired Paul Manafort. It really wasn't to run the campaign. It was that Paul Manafort had experience duking it out on the convention floor. Bloomberg's strategy, from what we're hearing right now, is to prepare for a floor fight. He's hired a bunch of experts that are there to basically whip votes and try to capture more votes and more delegate votes on a floor fight to eclipse Bernie Sanders. But Jesse, I just look, Sanders had a good argument that the nomination, absent of superdelegates, was stolen from him in 2016. If he is leading, has a dominant lead in delegates going into the convention, and the Democrats somehow steal it from him, oh my gosh. I mean, it will be nasty. Literally, the party will split at the seams.
It's a beautiful thing, John. John Thomas, host of the Thomas Guide podcast. I'm looking forward to it, my man. I'll see you soon.
Thanks, Jesse. Appreciate it.
We got more. Hang on. Iwo Jima. Everybody knows that name by now. We've all seen the John Wayne movie, Sands of Iwo Jima. We read about the battle for Iwo Jima in our history books. Look, Japan was a juggernaut. The United States of America had to dig out Japan from all these fortified islands across the South Pacific. And I know you've seen the movies, you've read the stories about it. It was horrific, and it was violent, and it was like nothing so many of these young men had ever experienced before, and they did amazing, brave things, and we should always take a moment, whenever possible, to salute them. So on Sunday, it was the 75th anniversary of the flag-raising thing on top of Mount Suribachi. Everybody knows that scene. That's Mount Suribachi where these guys are at the time. And those guys who raised the flag, I always thought that picture, that video, was extra special for a couple reasons. One, what they'd just gone through. Two, what they would go through, the guys who lived through that, the guys who raised that flag, were haunted. They were haunted by the things they saw on that island. And three of the guys you see right there did not survive the battle. You see, the raising of the flag on Mount Suribachi was not the end of the battle in Iwo Jima. It was a big moment. People cheered. It was nice. It was great for propaganda in the United States of America, but there was still fighting to do, and three of those guys would not live through it. And I always just thought it was a really cool thing to take a step back and salute those guys, because they did something incredible and brave and something that is iconic and that will live forever in the history of the United States of America, and they never knew it. They never got to know it. They were born, young men, went, fought, died, and did something awesome for this country. And so a salute to them, salute to all of our World War II veterans. And I know this is going to sound sappy, but you know better than that, I don't get sappy. If you know anybody who's a World War II veteran, give them a quick call, quick text, email, Facebook, however you communicate. And the reason I say that is, it's getting old. It's 2020, people. Those old timers are just about all gone now. So while you get a chance, say hello to them. And if you have the time in your life, I'd recommend you take time. Go sit down with one. Talk to them about it. You just might come away a better person than you were before. All right. We're going to do it again tomorrow. See you.